Hello everyone and welcome to this chapter where we're discussing the mechanical properties of solids, and in particular in this video we'll be discussing the idea of elasticity. Now first of all let me say that of all the chapters that we have discussed so far, we were always talking about bodies that were rigid. We defined the idea of a rigid body in the chapter rotation, and we saw that rigid bodies are those that have a definite shape or size and don't get deformed when external forces are applied to it. But here in this chapter, we will be studying the exact opposite. We will be looking at situations in which the shape or size of an object is changing because of the application of the force. So let's begin with the idea of elasticity in solids. In order to study the elastic behavior of solids, we have to first understand exactly what is happening inside a solid when an external force is applied. We know that inside solids, the molecules have a net fixed intermolecular separation. Now, this intermolecular separation is fixed, and therefore, at the natural separation, that is when nothing is being done to the solid, this is the natural separation, and therefore no net force is acting on the solid or between the molecules. However, now, if I apply an external force, which we will call as the external deforming force. So if you apply an external deforming force in such a way that you try to change the distance between the molecules, that is you either try to make them go apart or you try to bring them together, basically if you apply an external force with the reason that you want to change this distance, then what you will be doing is that because of this external application of force, there is a setup of forces inside the solid. So you applied a force, that was your action, and as a reaction, the solids set up internal forces. And this setup of internal forces, what does it do? Once you remove the deforming force, that is once you stop applying the external force, these molecules will try to go back to their original position. Why? Because of these internal forces that have been set up as a response to you applying the force on the solid. So once the removal of the deforming force occurs, the molecules will try to regain their original separation, and therefore the solid as a whole tries to regain its original size or shape. And this property of the solid, that is the property of a solid or a material body by virtue of which it tends to regain its original shape and size after the removal of a deforming force, this property is what we call as elasticity. And we have seen this property in objects around us. We all know that if we stretch a rubber band and release it, it comes back to its original position. In fact, that's the most famous example of elasticity. So what are the factors that affect elasticity? The factors affecting elasticity are four. The first factor is hammering or rolling. In brief, I would like to say that when you hammer or roll a material, you are basically breaking it up into pieces, and this causes an increase in the elastic property of the body. The second factor is annealing. Annealing is a method where you will heat a metal and you will cool it down in such a way that it becomes softer, and this process causes a decrease in the elastic property and increases the plastic property of the body. We'll see in a minute what the plastic property means. The next factor that affects elasticity is impurity. However, in case of impurity, it could lead to an increase or decrease in the elastic property of a body, and this depends on the nature of the impurity that you are adding to the object. And finally, we come to temperature. Usually, increasing the temperature will lead to a decrease in the intermolecular forces, and therefore, usually, this decreases the elastic property of objects. However, in case of some materials like Invar, which is an alloy, there will be no effect because it is independent of temperature. So these were the factors affecting elasticity. The next thing that I want to talk about is the deforming force. Now, usually when you apply an external force on a body, we have seen that according to Newton's second law, if I'm applying an external force, this means that an acceleration should be set up in the body. Then how are we saying that there is a change in the size or shape? Why are we not talking about the acceleration in the body? Well, there is a slight difference. The application of an external force does usually set up an acceleration in the body. However, if instead of applying an external force alone, if I set up two equal and opposite forces, that is a case in which the net force is zero, but there are two equal and opposite forces, and you apply these two equal and opposite forces on a body, you tend to change the size and shape of the body. Similar to the example where if you take a molding clay, you will close it with both hands. You are applying two equal and opposite forces on the clay, and this will lead to a change in shape of the body. Now, of course, in case of a clay, it's very easy to change the shape, but this logic will also work for objects that are harder. A steel bar, if applied sufficient external force on both sides, may get compressed if the external force is strong enough. And therefore, I say that if you apply two equal and opposite forces, in such a case, the net force will be zero, so there is no acceleration in the body, but this will lead to a change in size or shape of the body. And such a force, that is a force which tends to change the size or shape of the body, is what we call as the deforming force. By definition, it is the force applied on a body which changes the size or shape or both of the body. So these are some terms about the elasticity and the elastic behavior of solids. Now let's take a look at two of the most important concepts with respect to elasticity. These concepts are the concepts of stress and strain. The first concept is the concept of stress. Now, we have already discussed that in order to produce a deformation in the body, you will be applying some external deforming force. And as a response to that external deforming force, internal forces, which are restoring forces, are set up in the body. And using this idea, we can define what is known as stress. Stress is nothing but the sum total of the intermolecular forces, which is nothing but the restoring force per unit area. Now, I want to take this moment to clarify two important things about stress. The first one is that stress is not a force. Stress is force per unit area. The second one is that the force in question with respect to stress is not the external deforming force that you must have applied to the object, but the internal restoring forces which are set up in the body in response to the external deforming force. Those internal restoring forces per unit area is what is known as stress. So stress is associated with the internal restoring force in the body and not on the external deforming force. And therefore, I can write down the formula for stress. Stress is nothing but the force, restoring force divided by area, which I can write as F by A. Now again, do not confuse this with pressure. Pressure is also force per unit area, but stress is different because here the force is the restoring force which is set up in the body only in response to an external deforming force. So this is what is known as stress. But once you apply a deforming force, it may lead to a change in the dimension of the body. That's exactly what is known by deformation. And therefore, you can see in this example, this person is exercising in the gym. And when this person is applying an external deforming force, a deformation is produced in this elastic cord. Basically, this elastic cord is being changed in length. It is increasing in length. And therefore, this deformation which takes place in the body in the form of change in dimension is what we call as strain. By definition, we say that the fractional deformation produced by the external deforming force is known as strain. And because of the word fractional, we will have to write down the formula of strain in the form of a fraction. So let's see what is the formula for strain. Strain is nothing but the change in dimension divided by the original dimension. Now here the dimension could be length, or it could be area, or it could be volume. But overall in general we say it is the change in dimension upon the original dimension. And therefore here you can see that strain is a fractional deformation. Now stress and strain are related to different situations. First, let's take a look at this situation in which an external deforming force is being used to change the dimension of a body in terms of its length. So in this case, I have a rod, and on this rod, I will apply an external deforming force. That is, I will apply two equal and opposite forces along the length of the rod, which will produce a change in the length of this rod. And because of this, the length of the body, in this case the rod, will change along the line of action of force. And therefore, the stress in this situation, which is related to a change in length, is what we will call as the longitudinal stress. Therefore, I will say that longitudinal stress is that stress which is associated with a change in length of a body. So, whenever you have a deforming force which is trying to change the length of the body by applying two equal and opposite forces along the length of the body, such a force per unit area will be associated with the longitudinal stress. Now, longitudinal stress is nothing but the internal restoring force per unit area of cross section on which the force is applied parallel to the length and produces elongation in it. And therefore, the force per unit area associated with a change in length is what will be known as longitudinal stress. Now, longitudinal stress is of two types. It is tensile stress and compressive stress. This is because a change in length could mean an increase in length or it could mean a decrease in length. So whenever you have an outward force trying to increase the length of the object, then the stress produced in the object is known as the tensile stress. However, if you push the force inside, that is, if you have an inward force acting on an object trying to decrease the length of an object, then in that case the stress produced in that object is known as the compressive stress. So we have learned the first type of stress, that is longitudinal stress, which itself has two types, tensile or compressive, depending upon whether you are increasing the length or decreasing the length respectively. Now, related to this change in length, we will also define the longitudinal strain. Now, longitudinal strain is the strain which is related to that deformation where there is a change in length. And therefore, I will say that longitudinal strain by definition is change in length upon original length. This comes from the general formula that it is change in dimension upon original dimension. So, in this case, I will say it is change in length upon original length. And therefore, I will write down this formula as small l upon capital L, where small l is the change in length and capital L is the original length. But we'll also have situations in which we are not only changing the length, but we could be changing the volume of an object. Take a look at this stretchable ball. In this case, forces are applied in all directions. And these forces are not just applied uniformly in all directions, but they are applied perpendicular to the surface of the body. And they are causing an overall change in the dimensions of the body, which is leading to a change in volume. But keep in mind, they are changing the volume without changing the shape of the ball. The ball, which was completely spherical before, is now also spherical. However, we have applied forces uniformly in all directions and changed its volume. So, a change in volume without a change in shape is being caused by a uniform application of forces in all directions perpendicular to the surface of the body. And in this situation, we are talking about the bulk stress. So, bulk stress, which is also known as volume stress, is nothing but the normal means perpendicular, internal restoring force per unit area which produces a change in volume of a substance. Remember, we applied forces in all directions uniformly perpendicular to the surface of the body, and in response to that, restoring forces were set up in the body, and these restoring forces per unit area is what we call as the bulk or the volume stress. Now, from this, you can also understand that if I try to change the volume of an object, just like I'm doing with this stretched rubber ball, in such a case, if I decrease the volume of an object, the pressure inside will increase. And therefore, I can say that when forces are applied perpendicularly inward, as such in our case, at each point of the surface, this will result in an increase in pressure. And of course, the opposite is also true. If you will apply forces perpendicularly outward at each point of the surface, this will result in a decrease of pressure. So I can say that the bulk or volume stress is associated with a change in pressure. And therefore, only in the case of a volume change, that is a volume deformation, bulk stress is also the same as a change in pressure. However, initially, for the overall definition, I in fact warned you that stress is not the same as pressure, even though it is force per unit area, but in terms of the bulk or volume stress, it comes out to be equal to the change in pressure. So remember that the bulk stress is nothing but delta P, which is the change in pressure. Now, from this, I can also define the bulk strain or the volume strain. And by definition of strain, I will know that volume strain will be nothing but the change in volume upon the original volume. Change in volume is nothing but the delta V, that is the increase in volume or the decrease in volume, divided by capital V, which is the original volume. So this gives me the volume stress and the volume strain in the case when I am changing the volume by applying forces uniformly perpendicular to the surface of the body without changing the shape. The next type of situation in which a different kind of stress is produced is a situation in which you apply two parallel and opposite forces on a body, but they are not along the same line. For example, I am applying a force on this book. On the cover of this book, my hand is pushing this book in one particular direction. The friction between the book and the surface is pushing it in the other direction. And these two are equal and opposite, but they are not along the same line. And because they are not along the same line, what will happen is that they will produce a deformation. So I say that in this case, two parallel and opposite deforming forces are applied parallel to the cross-sectional area of the object. The cross-sectional area of this book is nothing but the view from which we can see a rectangle. And now, because of these parallel and opposite deforming forces, which don't lie along the same line, the stress that will be produced in this body is what we call as the shear stress. So, the shear or the tangential stress is nothing but the tangential internal restoring force per unit area, which will produce a change in the shape of the body. So let me remind you that in the first case, that is in the longitudinal case, we only produced a change in length. In the bulk case, we produced a change in volume without changing the shape of the body. However, in the shear case, we are changing the shape of the body by applying two parallel and opposite forces which are not along the same line. And this force is tangential to the cross-sectional area. And this will cause restoring forces to set up in the body. And this restoring force per unit area is what we call as the shear or the tangential stress. Now, looking at this idea with respect to our particular example, we see that the shear or tangential stress formula is nothing but the applied tangential force upon the area, that is the cross-sectional area of the object. For this case, then, we can also define the strain. The strain, by definition, will be the shear strain, and it will be given by the lateral displacement of any layer. In this case, the change in dimension is the movement of the layer. So, the lateral displacement of any layer divided by the distance from the fixed layer. If you think about this with respect to our example of the book, then the topmost layer on which my hand is placed, this layer has moved, and the lateral displacement of this layer is what we will call as x, and therefore the numerator of my formula will be x. However, the topmost layer has a distance h from the fixed layer. The fixed layer is the lowermost layer which is stuck to the surface of the table. This fixed layer and the layer which has moved have a perpendicular distance of h, which is nothing but the height of the book. And therefore, the shear strain formula will come out to be shear strain is equal to x by h. And you can see from the diagram of the book that after it has given a deformation, that is, after shear deformation has taken place, you will see that x by h is nothing but the tan of the theta. And for very small theta, I can approximate tan theta as theta itself. And so I can also say that shear strain is nothing but the theta, where theta is the angle as shown in the figure. Now, the most important relationship between stress and strain is what is known as Hooke's law. Now, Robert Hooke came up with the relationship between stress and strain, and he basically said that stress was directly proportional to strain, which means that stress is equal to E times strain, where E is some constant, which we will talk about in a moment. However, this Hooke's law is basically saying that within the elastic limit, the stress developed in a body is directly proportional to the strain produced in it. The value of E, which is the constant of proportionality, is independent of the dimensions of the body. In the most simple words, it means that if I plot a graph between the stress and the strain, then within the elastic limit, this graph will turn out to be a straight line, because here Hooke's law is defining a linear relationship between the quantities of stress and strain. Now, for most materials, for small values of strain, Hooke's law is obeyed. However, if you keep on increasing the stress, then at some point the strain increases beyond a certain value and this proportionality is lost. But for most materials under certain conditions, that is within small values of strain, Hooke's law is obeyed, that is stress is directly proportional to strain. Now, the relation between the stress and the strain for a given material under tensile stress can be found experimentally. You can see here that we are doing a standard test of tensile properties by testing a wire which is being stretched by an applied force. This wire is fixed at one end and is free to move at the other end. At the free end, we are applying different amounts of force, and what we will do is record the values of the applied force and the fractional change in length, which is nothing but the strain. We can find the stress by knowing the values of force that we have applied, and we can find the strain by measuring the change in length that we have caused in this wire. Now, using this example where we are testing the tensile properties of this wire, we can plot the stress-strain relationship for this wire and study the general properties of the stress-strain curve. Basically, we are plotting the stress-strain graph, and we start by pulling this wire from the free end, which is nothing but application of load at the free end. And when we start pulling this wire, then for small values of the change in length of the wire, we will see that if we plot this graph, then between O to A, we will find that this region represents the elastic region, which means within this region, restoring forces are present in the wire and they are trying to regain its shape once the robotic arm releases the end of the wire which it is pulling. Now remember that this represents the elastic region, but also, as you can see from the graph, this region is also the region where stress and strain are directly proportional. We know this because it is a straight line relationship, and therefore this is also the region in which Hooke's law is obeyed. Now, whether a material is elastic and whether it obeys Hooke's law are two different conditions. In this region, it is not only elastic, but it is obeying Hooke's law because stress and strain have a linear relationship. The point A, which is the final point at which Hooke's law is obeyed, is known as the proportional limit. Because at the point A, it is the final value of strain for which stress and strain have a linear relationship. At any point beyond A, the relationship will no longer be linear. And therefore, now if I start to increase the values of strain, that is, I start to increase the change in length by pulling harder and harder by the robotic arm, then between A and B, I will see that even though the material is still elastic, the wire is still going back to its original length, however, between A and B, stress and strain no longer have a linear relationship. And therefore, between A and B, Hooke's law is not obeyed. However, as I have already said, the material is still elastic. And therefore, I will say that even within A and B, the material has elasticity but no proportionality between stress and strain. Overall, I will say that Hooke's law is not obeyed in this region, and at any point between A and B, the material, however, is still elastic. Point B is known as the elastic limit or the yield point. B is the final point after which the material will no longer be elastic. Remember, A was the point up to which stress and strain were proportional. after A also the material is elastic, but beyond B the material is no longer elastic, and therefore B is known as the elastic limit or the yield point. By definition, the elastic limit is the maximum deforming force up to which a body retains its property of elasticity. And the stress associated with this point B is what we call as the yield strength, S with a subscript Y. This is the tensile strength. Now, in this region between O to B, as I have said, the material is definitely elastic, which means that if I pull the wire between O to B, that is with a force which lies between O and B, if I pull it in such a way that the value of strain is between the points O and B, then in such a case, the wire will regain its original length, because here the wire has elasticity. However, even though the wire might come back to its original length, it will take some time to do so, and this is known as the elastic after effect. The time delay in which the substance regains its original condition after the removal of deforming force is known as the elastic after effect. Now, what happens when I increase the values of strain beyond the point B? That is, I apply more and more force by pulling the wire, that is by increasing the change in length of the wire. When I do this, I will see that for any point lying between point B and D, if I take a point, let's say a point C, at this point, that is for this value of strain, I will see that if the load is removed, then the body will not regain its original length. And this is obvious because B was the elastic limit. Beyond B, if you apply more stress, that is if you increase the value of strain produced in the body, then beyond B, the object on releasing the deforming force will still not regain its original length. So it might go back to some other length which might not be its original length, and therefore we say that in this region, that is between B and D, the object exhibits plastic behavior. And then if I pull the wire and release at this point C, I will see that the length of the wire goes back not to its original position but to some in-between position, and therefore this distance between O and C on the strain axis is what we call as the permanent strength, because now the wire will not go back to its original position but it will stop at some further position from the origin, and this distance between O and the point at which the wire goes back is known as the permanent set on the strain axis of the stress strain curve. Now remember that this material is exhibiting plastic behavior, and this is known as the permanent set. This deformation is said to be plastic deformation because now the object is exhibiting plasticity, which means that even after removing the deforming force, it is not regaining its original size or shape. The stress associated with the point D is known as the tensile strength, denoted by S subscript U. This is the tensile or the ultimate strength of the material. Beyond this point D, additional strain is produced even if you decrease the applied force. So even if I reduce the amount of force with which I am pulling the wire by the robotic arm, even if I reduce the force, the strain produced will increase beyond this point D. And therefore, at point E, as the object becomes worse and worse, that is the cross-sectional area will keep on reducing, and at point E, the wire will finally break. And therefore, we say that fracture occurs at point E. Point E is known as the fracture point or the breaking point, and the stress associated with point E is known as the breaking stress. By definition, breaking stress is then the maximum stress which can be tolerated by the wire before breaking. Now note, however, that between the points D and E, even decreasing the force was producing more strain on the material. In fact, we saw that the cross-sectional area of the material was decreasing between the points D and E. Now, these points D and E are close to each other for brittle materials, that is, materials which break easily. And they will be far apart for ductile materials, that is, materials which can be stretched into long wires. Finally, elastic fatigue is what is known as the temporary loss of elastic properties because of the action of repeated alternating deforming force. So if I keep on pulling the wire again and again and letting it go back to its original position, then after a while there will be a temporary loss in its elasticity, and this is known as elastic fatigue. It might go away after a considerable period of time. And these are the properties of the stress strain curve. In general, we have learned very importantly that for brittle materials, the point D and E will be close to each other and will be far apart. For ductile materials, the material will exhibit Hooke's law behavior, that is, proportionality between stress and strain, only for a small region, and usually we use only this region, that is the elastic limit of this region, for elasticity purposes. Next, we define what is known as the elastic moduli. Remember that E that we wrote in Hooke's law? That is nothing but the modulus of elasticity. Now, by definition, the elastic modulus or the modulus of elasticity is the ratio of the stress and the strain. And therefore, I will say that elastic moduli is stress upon strain. Now, elastic modulus, which is nothing but E, is characteristic of the material. And in general, because there are three types of strain and three types of stress, elastic modulus or modulus of elasticity is also of three types. That is, you'll have the Young's modulus, which is associated with length, the Bourque's modulus associated with a change in volume without a change in shape, and the shear modulus associated with the tangential stress and strain. So let's take a look at these one by one. We first take a look at the Young's modulus. And as we know, the Young's modulus will be associated with a change in length or with the longitudinal stress and strain. And therefore, by definition of elastic modulus, Y, which is the Young's modulus, will be a ratio of the longitudinal stress and the longitudinal strain. And therefore, we can say that Y is equal to F by A, which is the longitudinal stress, divided by small l by capital L, which is the longitudinal strain. This gives me the formula for the Young's modulus. An experimental arrangement for finding the Young's modulus of the material of a wire is shown. In this case, the beam is made up of a material for which we want to find the Young's modulus. We will use the method of bending of the beam to find the Young's modulus of this material. In the experimental setup, this beam is supported at its ends by two stands. A portion of the length of the beam lies outside the stands on both ends. And therefore, for measurements, only the length of the beam lying between the two stands is what is counted. At the center of mass of the beam, we have placed this hanger. This hanger is right now empty. However, in the experiment, it will be added with weight. At the top of this hanger is a needle. Using the traveling microscope, we will focus the cross hairs of the microscope upon the needle. We will do this when no weight has been added, and this will be the zero reading. Eventually, we will add weights to this hanger, and on adding a sufficient amount of weight, say in counts of 500 gram, each time we will see that the rod is bending. Because the rod is bending, the needle will no longer be focused in the microscope. Using the traveling microscope's scale, we will bring the needle back into the focus of the cross hairs and then note down this reading. The difference between this reading and the zero reading will give me the depression or the sag of the rod due to the weight that we have applied. This weight applied will be W, which is also known as the load. The difference in the readings will give me the depression, which we call as del. Using these values, we will use the formula for the depression or sag of a rod, which says that del is equal to W L cube upon 4 B D cube Y. Here del is the depression or the sag that we are measuring, W is the weight that we are applying, L is the length of the beam within the stands, B is its breadth, D is its depth, and Y is the Young's modulus that we have to find. We will increase the weights in amounts of 500 grams and then note the readings each time. We will also repeat the experiment while decreasing the weights. Using a large number of readings, then we will find the mean depression, put it in the formula just mentioned, and obtain the Young's modulus of the material of the beam. The second type of modulus is the bulk modulus, and this is generally associated with fluids. This is because when our body is submerged in a fluid, the fluid will exert force in all directions on the body perpendicular to the surface of the body. For example, we saw the stretched rubber ball before. If this ball is submerged within a liquid, say water, then the water will exert forces on the ball in all directions uniformly and perpendicular to the surface of the body, which is exactly what we saw is the meaning of bulk stress. And therefore we say that when a body is submerged in a fluid, then we start talking about the bulk modulus. And when this body is submerged, it undergoes a hydraulic pressure, that is, it undergoes a hydraulic stress equal in magnitude to the hydraulic pressure. We saw that when you try to decrease the volume of an object without changing its shape, there will be an increase in pressure. And from that logic alone, we can say that the bulk stress is a change in pressure. And now we have to also write down what is the bulk strain. The bulk stress will lead to a decrease in the volume of the body without a change in shape. This will produce the strain, which is the volume strain or the bulk strain. And the bulk strain will be nothing but the change in volume divided by the original volume. This is the definition of strain. Using this formula for bulk stress and bulk strain, we can write down the bulk modulus, that is, B is equal to volume stress upon volume strain, which is nothing but the hydraulic stress upon hydraulic strain, and hydraulic stress is nothing but delta P, that is, the change in pressure divided by the hydraulic strain, which is delta V by V. The minus sign here indicates that the increasing pressure will cause a change or a decrease in volume. The minus sign here indicates that increasing the pressure will cause a decrease in volume and vice versa. The reciprocal of the bulk modulus is known as the compressibility factor, that is K, and K will then be equal to 1 by B. The last type of modulus is the shear modulus. The shear modulus is given by the symbol eta and is defined as the ratio of shearing stress upon shearing strain. We already know that the shearing stress will be nothing but the tangential force divided by the area, that is F by A, and we have seen that the shearing strain is nothing but X by H, and therefore eta, which is the shear modulus, will be F by A divided by X by H. But we also saw that for small values of strain, we could write X by H as tan theta and approximate it to theta itself. From this, I will get the formula that eta, which is the shear modulus, is equal to F by A theta. Now, these were the three moduli of elasticity. But there is one other property of elasticity that we must remember. Now, the shear modulus usually can be related to the Young's modulus in such a way that for most materials, the shear modulus is 1/3 of the Young's modulus. So, I can say eta, which is the shear modulus, is equal to y by 3, where y is the Young's modulus. The shear modulus is also known as the modulus of rigidity. Now, these were the three types of elastic moduli. There is one other ratio that is extremely important to the study of elasticity, and that is the Poisson ratio. The Poisson ratio comes into play when you talk about a wire being stretched. Let's say you are stretching a wire on both ends. Now, let's say that initially the wire had some length, which we will call as capital L, and some radius of cross-section, that is small r. When you begin to stretch the wire, you will see that the length of the wire is increasing, and once you remove the deforming force, that is, you stop stretching the wire, we will see that this extra final length is nothing but L dash, which is the increased length due to elongation of the wire. Because of this elongation, there will be a difference in the original length and the final length, which we will call as small l. But we will also see that not only has the length of the wire increased, the cross-sectional area of the wire has decreased, that is, the radius of the wire has gone down. Initially, the wire had some radius, which we called as small r. Now, the new radius of cross-section, which is r dash, is lesser than the original radius. So we can say that on stretching a wire, we will see that while the length increases, however, the cross-sectional area decreases, which means that the radius decreases. The initial increase in length is what we call as the longitudinal strain. However, there is also a decrease in the radius of the cross-section, and this is known as the lateral strain. And using these two strains, we can define the Poisson ratio. The Poisson ratio comes into play when a deforming force is applied at the free end of a suspended wire of length L and radius R, which we have just seen. This increases its length by small l, causing longitudinal strain, but the radius decreases by dr, which causes lateral strain, and we define the Poisson ratio as the ratio of lateral strain, which we call beta, divided by the longitudinal strain, which we call alpha. And therefore, I can write down Poisson ratio as beta by alpha. The beta is nothing but the lateral strain, that is the change in radius upon the original radius, that is dr by r, and longitudinal strain is nothing but the change in length divided by the original length, that is L by capital L. The minus sign indicates that increasing the length decreases the radius and vice versa. And this is the Poisson ratio, which will be written as minus dr by r into capital L by small l. And this is the final ratio that is important to us while discussing elasticity. Now, next we will talk about the elastic energy that is stored in a body. Now, whenever a body is subject to a deforming force and it starts to regain its original state, how exactly is it regaining its original state? It is regaining its original state because the force of elasticity is acting on the body. And this force of elasticity is acting through a distance, making the body regain its original shape. And because this force of elasticity is acting throughout the distance, that is throughout the size of the body, we can say that this force of elasticity is also doing some work on the body, and this work done by the internal restoring force or by the elastic force itself is stored in the body as the elastic potential energy. And this is given by the formula half into the stretching force applied into the extension in the wire, which simply speaking I can say is half into stress into strain into volume. These two formulae are the same and can be used depending upon the problem to be solved. Now, similarly, I can say that when you are actually extending the wire, that is producing an extension in the wire, that is stretching a wire, the deforming force is doing some work in the wire because it is producing an extension over a certain distance. And this work done in stretching a wire, denoted by capital W, will be given as an integral of yax by L into dx going from 0 to L, which comes out to be half f into L. Simply speaking, if you look at the term yax upon L, if you look at this term, you will see that it is a multiplication of the Young's modulus into the area into the strain, because x by L is nothing but the strain. And where does this come from? We know that the modulus is nothing but stress upon strain. So if I want stress, then it will be Young's modulus into strain. But I don't want stress, I want force, which is nothing but stress into area. And therefore, I will say that force is stress into area, but stress itself is Young's modulus into strain, and therefore force will be Young's modulus into strain into area, which is yax by L. And this is multiplied by the extension because fdx is what is work, and therefore yax by L represent force, that is F, and dx is the extension, and then you integrate this from 0 to L, giving me half F into L. And this work done due to stretching the wire, that is work done by the force applied, this work done is then stored into the body as the strain energy. So in this case, W is equal to half F into L, where F is nothing but YAL by capital L, that is small l is the total change in length, and capital L is the original length. And this work done is stored into the wire in the form of strain energy, and therefore I can say W is nothing but the strain energy given by half into load into the extension caused. Now, using this, I can write down what is the strain energy per unit volume. Strain energy was nothing but W, which we saw, that is half into F into L. So, strain energy per unit volume would be half into F into L divided by volume. And volume is nothing but area into length, so that's A into L. Now, you can split this up and write it as half into F by A into L by L, which would be nothing but half into stress into strain, which can also be written as half into stress squared by Y, where Y is the Young's modulus, or it could be written as half into Y into strain squared. So this is the work done in stretching a wire, and these are important formulae related to the strain energy and the elastic potential energy which would be stored in the wire. Next, let's take a look at the applications of elastic behavior in materials. Engineering designs require precise knowledge of these elastic properties of different materials. One of the most important applications is the understanding of beams, which are used in constructions of bridge and other structures. Let's consider the case of a beam which is loaded at the center and supported near its ends. In such a case, there will be a depression or sag of the rod due to the load W, which is supported at the center. And this depression or sag is given by the formula W L cube upon 4Y BD cube. In this case, W is the load, L is the length, Y is the Young's modulus, B is the breadth, D is the depth of the rod. In order to reduce this bending for a given load, it is obvious then from the formula that the Young's modulus should be very large. And therefore, we could use a material with a very large Young's modulus, that is with a very large Y. From the formula, it is clear that for a minimum value of the sag, the value of the length should be as low as possible and the value of the depth should be as high as possible. This is because the sag is directly proportional to the cube of the length and inversely proportional to the cube of the depth. However, on increasing the depth, unless the load is exactly at the right place, the deep bar may bend. This will produce what is known as buckling. To avoid buckling, a common compromise is the cross-sectional shape as shown. Thus, we can say that too much increase in depth leads to the bending of beam or buckling, which is overcome by creating I-shaped girders. In another application of the elastic behavior of materials, we can also understand that for lifting and moving heavy loads, cranes are used. These cranes must have a very thick metal rope so that the load attached can be supported. To lift such heavy loads, the wire of the crane must be of large thickness. This is because we know that stress is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area. And for a rope, the cross-sectional area is a circular area, and therefore the stress will be inversely proportional to R square, representing the second power proportionality of the area of a circle. And because stress is inversely proportional to R square, the greater the thickness of the rope, the less will be the stress exerted upon it. So this completes the recap of all the important concepts of elasticity. I hope you were able to quickly revise all the fundamental concepts of the chapter. Thank you for watching this memory map. So thank you for watching this memory map on elasticity. If you like our channel, please subscribe by hitting this button here. And if you want to buy your very own target book, you can find it at the link by hitting this button here. Please keep watching our channel and continue watching for more updates.